Thank you so much. So I'd like to thank Ransco as well as Dr. Vignesh for giving me this opportunity to be participating in your session. So I'll be just highlighting a few tips on how to surgically manage complications of proliferative diabetic retinopathy. So conventionally, when we see the indications for vitrectomy in diabetic retinopathy have been a non-resolving vitreous hemorrhage, tractional retinal detachment either threatening or involving the fovea, combined mechanical retinal detachment, and progressive disease leading to neovascular glaucoma. But in recent times, this has expanded to doing surgery in patients who are not adequately responding to PRP laser, and people who have a vitreomacular retraction. This has been picked up after the advent of OCT in our practice, and the presence of epithelial membrane, which can be sometimes a cause for intractable diabetic macular edema. And even though tractional papillopathy is a sort of a controversial topic, people have shown that operating can relieve the traction and lead to resolution of the disc edema. So one more recent indication which we normally do in our practice is nasal traction, where you can see that the anatomy of the macula is totally altered. Even though the fovea itself is surgically, is attached to the RPE, you can see that the pseudo disc edema of the overlying retina, the alteration in the architecture of the arcades, and the shortening of the distance between the fovea and the disc margin. So if you look at the fovea itself, it shows it's totally normal, but when you look at the shortening of the distance, this can lead to slow onset vision loss. Unlike a fovea involving a vitreal macular traction, this takes a long time for the vision to drop, and operating date may not be able to recover the lost vision, so it's better to operate early. So first thing is, like, when you have a complicated case like this in your practice, always the heart comes to the mouth, or how are we going to operate, will we be able to achieve the success, both functional as well as visual outcome related? Will I be able to take care of the intraoperative complications, especially bleeding, and prevent retinal breaks from happening? So the first, I feel, is it's all a mental game. So you have to be a little bit at peace with your heart and not get too much excited. And always try to have a plan on how we're going to navigate the various additions which are in place. You can make this plan when you're sitting in the clinic and looking at it through a slit lamp or indirect, or you can do on the table when you're getting a more clearer view with the line end of the meter. You can make a plan on how to you go about. Try to stick to this plan unless there's some hurdle, significant hurdle in, you may have to change your direction of plan of action. So again, try to deal with these things as you would play like a Mario Bros video game. Don't try to initially visualize the final outcome. Go in step by step, like you would play a matador. Don't think of saving the princess in the first stage itself. You try to visualize yourself only finishing the first stage, going to the next stage, so on and so forth. So just try to sort of phase or stage your surgical procedures in small stages, so that you don't get tired both mentally and physically. So there are two types of going about. This is one is reaching the membranes from outside in, or otherwise from inside out, from the disc towards the periphery. I feel that the more complicated the membrane, it's better to go from outside in. If it's the simple membranes, you can go from the disc itself because it gets you the surgical pain immediately. It's good for simple membranes, but there's a little bit of higher risk of bleeding because you may rupture the major neovascular fronts at the center near the disc or at the disc itself. A lot of times, once the membrane becomes loose, you may need to go for a bimodal technique. Outside in, I feel it's much more easier to operate in complicated membranes. Only thing is the getting the initial edge is a little bit difficult. This is showing an inside out technique in a very young patient who had a very significant membranes with no posterior vitreous detachment. So I'm trying to make a nick. Usually the membranes are too taut and you may need to make a small rent with a sharp instrument. I usually use the 27 gauge bent needle to make the initial rent, and then this rent can be enlarged using your either the 27 gauge retractor or the 25 gauge retractor, which is ideal for navigating this scenario. And try to look at all the additions and try to make them into small islands, what you would call as a segmentation in the olden days. But here we don't leave those segments, just trim it off as close as possible and address the bleeding also. Just go about trying to make those into small islands and then trim it off. So again, as I said, don't try to visualize the whole membrane being removed. Just finish off the superior quadrant, then the inferior temporal quadrant or inferior quadrant, and try to go face wise. So just trying to navigate as and we go. We're trying to identify the epicenters or addition points, and then isolating it and trimming it off. So in cases a little bit more complicated, as I said, you have to make this mental plan. And I usually plan for operating. I am a right-handed person. I try to choose the superior temporal quadrant in the right eye and the superior nasal quadrant in the left eye, because that's how my hand is oriented. And going from top to bottom is much more convenient because your instruments are oriented that way. So the first step is always trying to address the second membrane. This is the membrane just below the PVD. Once you cut the PVD and enter the subhyoid space, you have to use a sharp instrument to sort of get the second membrane out. This is very critical to get a surgical success, because if you're operating the plane beneath the PVD, you're going to get difficult membrane peeling, leading to multiple iatrogenic unintended breaks and also uncontrollable bleeding. So first step is always to identify the second membrane. Second membrane is just a small translucent or transparent membrane, which is seen around the epicenters or where the neuruses arise, and can be seen apart from PDR, can be seen in other vascular disorders also. So I told you it's very transparent or translucent, and edge is not always clear. Some people have used various stains to identify, but it's not easy. So if you can look at the OCT, you can see that the enlarged picture can show the thin membrane running along the surface of the retina, apart from the PVD, which is seen superiorly. So always expect that the second membrane is in place, and then go about addressing it, because if you're not in the correct plane, you're basically, sometimes the membranes are very tight, like you see in this picture, or sometimes it's a little bit more looser in some of the cases. So depending upon how it is, you want to choose your instruments. And also you should keep in mind that sometimes the second membrane can run from arcade to arcades in some of the patients along the across the macula, and leaving this without addressing it can lead to late onset epithelial membrane formation after 3 4 months following surgery. So again, I was just a small video showing the importance. This is the PVD and the second membrane, which is running across the surface of the retina onto the PVD. So if you are trying to work in the subhyoid plane, that's not the right plane. You're going to get a lot of complications. So always try to address the second membrane, lift it up, and then that is your second membrane plane is your ideal surgical plane, because this can convert so-called plaque adhesions into multiple point adhesions, that by making it much more easier to address. This is just showing a video when a loose adhesion, you can see just with the cutter itself, I'm able to elevate the second membrane and get into the surgical plane. So what looks like a big tabletop sort of a plaque becomes multiple point adhesions. I can use my cutter delamination to feed the tissue into the and use slightly low suction and short bursts of cutting to address this membrane. So this case with a loose membrane where suction was enough to lift, but in cases like this where it is much more flatter and tougher and stronger adhesion, you may have to use the sharp instruments like I showed in the first case. I usually use the 27 gauge bent needle, which the dental surgeons use for injecting for gum anesthesia. So that is usually helpful in this. Just once you lift that, you can see it is almost a transparent or membrane. And once you lift that, that's your surgical plane. Then you can switch to your forceps and go about peeling these membranes much more, a little bit easier and safer way, if we can call that. So again, as I told you, sometimes you can see that the membranes are running from this vertical scan showing the arcade to arcade involvement of the second membrane. Sometimes you forget that you fail to recognize this on table, and it can lead to late onset. I'm just showing a case where you can see now this is a PVD. There's a vitreomacular traction and a small cyst there. So I was not able to see the membrane, but then I realized that there's a very transparent second membrane there running from our inferior arcade to the superior arcade. So one eyed patient with a superior TRD with a vitreomacular cyst as well. So unless you identify this, you're going to the risk of getting iatrogenic breaks also is quite high. In this particular patient, you're able to get away without any tampering, because we are able to avoid iatrogenic break. You can see then here I'm shifting to bimodal technique to address the superior membrane, which is very taut. But you can see that as I remove it, you'll be able to see the two membranes. What I'm holding is the PVD, and what is just a transparent floating membrane beneath that is the second membrane. So you should always make sure that you identify that correctly, because it is critical to make your surgery much more easier as well as less complicated. So when you're in the right plane, what looks like a sort of so-called plaque will become into multiple points. Here, what looks like a tabletop plaque at the superior arcade is converted to a multiple points as you go in the, you can see that the flow of the membrane across there, and you can see just now it's 4 points there. Once it is trimmed, it is just 4 points rather than a plaque. So if you're on the right plane, true plaques do exist, but it's less common. So what looks like plaques are usually multiple closely placed point adhesions. So when you're dealing with disc membranes, you also remember that it's important to address the second membrane here as well. So So if there's a large membrane, usually when you reach the second membrane plane, it leads to disc normally. But in cases where only there's a large fibrovascular proliferation on the disc, you have to correctly go about putting this. Otherwise, the chance of creating peripapillary tears or rupturing the major vessels at this juncture can be catastrophic, especially if you're rupturing an artery wall, it's going to be catastrophic and that can be the end of surgery. So being the right plane, there's a very, very less risk of rupturing either the retina or the major vessels at this critical point. I'm just showing one more case here where the second membrane was almost not visible. So I had finished all the membranes. I'm trying to address it. It was a little bit difficult, but then I realized there was a small membrane running across the disc. So I'm just elevating with my 27-gauge needle there. And so once you identify that, then it's once you peel that, what was tenacious looking nasal fibrous proliferation was easy to remove. That's, you can see that now it's coming off. There was a second membrane there. And what looked a little bit tenacious, trying to work around this, was not coming off easily. But then once I went into the second membrane plane, you can see it's coming off without much of an issue there. So again, during the olden era, the various techniques were described by especially Steve Charles gave all these names. Segmentation, where you just leave off large bits by dividing them and bisecting them into small pieces. Delamination is where you try to use scissors to divide the adhesions. And end block, where you cut the major part of the vitreous after releasing all the adhesions. In MIBS, again, we have different names: conformal delamination, foldback delamination, and lawnmower technique. All are just various fancy names for the routine technique. End block in the olden days was just releasing the adhesion first using especially the horizontal scissors, and then releasing that, and then finally removing the vitreous. That's what how it was described in the olden days. And segmentation is not usually followed because of the very poor outcomes. You just divide the membranes and leave it there to avoid retinotomies, but it's not a good technique nowadays. Conformal delamination is where your cutter is facing the membrane and you can trim very close. The risk is that in a tenacious membrane or thin mobile retina, you can eat the retina also. So that's why you have to a little bit take care about. So so also whenever you feel that nowadays we see that use after the advent of micron vitrectomy system, the use of scissors and forceps will a little bit come down. So scissors is a very important role to play, especially in chronic arteries where the retina is very thin and the adhesions are more severe. So scissors gives you a much more safer way to release all these adhesions compared to cutter. So cutter delamination is easy and much more simpler only if you employ it in less stiff membranes and nice thick retina, so not mobile. So in mobile retina and thin retina, scissors also gives you a very neat and surgical separation of the tissues. So when you're doing a cutter delamination, always cut in short bursts, especially in a mobile retina, feed the tissue into the mouth and give short bursts so that you don't accidentally eat up the retina. This helps in preventing iatrogenic retinal injury, especially when you're dealing with the thin and mobile retinas. So again, showing a small video on how a conformal delamination is done. Just feed that up and then give short bursts. This is a common mechanism already, as you can see. So don't cut in full force, just give short bursts so that you have a lesser risk of injuring the retina, especially near the macular zone. Foldback can be employed as the initial stage to identify the surgical plane. Just here, the cutter is facing the opposite to the retina. It gives you a little bit a view of what is underneath. You can see here the fold back, it's what's happening. The membrane is falling back into the cutter. It gives you a little bit better view of what is underneath, so you can go about planning your. It's a sort of intermediate technique before you go ahead and address the membranes in a proper way. So peeling disc membrane, sometimes if you're in the correct plane, it's much more easier, as I showed you. So what you see here is sometimes during this peeling technique, you can have a disc bleed. So when you have a disc bleed, sometimes people get upset or what's going to happen here. So as I told you, when you're trying to peel the membranes on the disc, usually in a chronic TRDs, you have a crater-like cavity there. So trying to address the membranes in anterior posterior direction can create iatrogenic breaks. So you go about peeling them in a more tangential way. You have to hold it in the deep crater, part of the crater, and then slowly pull it across on the more tangential way rather than anteroposterior, because that can create a lot of traction and create iatrogenic cells. So hold it in the central area and then try to peel it in a more tangential force rather than a vertical force. A just showing a case of disc bleeding. Whenever disc bleeding, sometimes people get very excited, especially the junior doctors. So always make a call on what is bleeding, whether it's a ruptured NVD, a ruptured venule, or a ruptured arteriole. Arteriole is one of the drastic complaints and very difficult to control. Usually what bleeds is the ruptured neovascular membrane of the disc that can be controlled by raising the bottle height. In case it is not stopping with full bottle height, you can use a little bit of pressure with a blunt instrument, sometimes the soft tip cannula or with the cutter itself. We used to have some ball-shaped device for this, retina massager, but it's not available with the MIVS. It will help you to stop the bleeding in case of bleeding which does not get controlled with the raising of the bottle height. Then you have the visco dissection, which is a learning technique. You can use visco stain with the BBG to do peeling across the macula. It's a bit safer, but it's not a great technique. And also bimodal technique, as I already showed you, it's very helpful to deal with very tenacious membranes and paired retina is very thin. So if you do it everything in the correct way, you'll be able to get a very happy outcome. I think I'll stop the PPT here. Thank you.